The Silver Roof. What next? It was a hot... It was a hot, dark Chicago night. Ha, 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 ha. Aren't you glad that's not part of the story? Maybe there was something to that Jacob's Ladder movie after all. Maybe they did put hallucinogens in our food at the mess hall. I used to call it the secret weapon. The guided mess hall. Heck, in the wintertime, the birds flew overhead, and you had to watch out for the ICBMs. Maybe Uncle Sam did actually visit it. Whoa, man. It's coming. I used to be able to read coherently here. Now, ever since they raised me on Dick and Jane there. Spot. Oh, my God. I forgot the name of the cat. Anyway. I mean, I've even forgotten what Spot looked like. I guess Spot had spots. Must have been a Dalmatian, huh? Run, Jane, run, 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 run. You know, when they got to the third one, you wondered, am I reading this right? Because nobody would ever talk like that, you know. Now, I mean, sometimes. But anyway, Dick and Jane, that was like the way they taught us how to read back in the day. So anyway, all right, you know, I used to call that mess hall the secret weapon, the guided mess hall. Okay, you remember Arlo Guthrie, you know? No, you don't. I guess not. You can get anything you want at Alice's restaurant. This communist started to operate a restaurant somewhere in upstate New York, and turned out to be a great success. Really cool. And, you know, it's like, so Arlo wrote a song about it, and he used to, you know, visit down at WBAI in that huge building that's, you know, actually they built a building right, you know, that's elevated off the highway right in the middle of, I can't remember the place now, Lexington Avenue, you know, and I used to park over Lexington Avenue and somewhere, I think it was like 51st Street or something, and, you know, when I was driving the cab, and I'd bop in and to the studio and talk with my friend Bob Fass over there. He's doing Radio Unnameable somewhere in the wee hours of the night, you know. And every now and then I'd be, you know, listening in. I didn't have FM radio in the cab in those days. You know, what we did is, like, usually by that time the cabs we used, the antennas were broken off by vandalism or something else, and we used to. Sometimes you put a, when you stuck the coat hanger in the cab, what was left of the antenna at the base, you could get a signal. So I'd, you know, listen to AM, mostly classical. But when I was in art school years before, you know, before I went through the army thing, I used to listen to radio on Name a Bull at night when I did a lot of my painting. Oh, I kicked the kicker. I mean, we're okay. I know I owe everybody else. So anyway, you know, every now and then he'd invite Arlo Guthrie in. I'm pretty sure Bob Fass actually helped Bob Dylan get a start. One time Bob Dylan came in there, you knew it was him by his voice, but he wouldn't let Bob Fass say who was there. People used to drop into that little studio out there in that huge building. Arlo Guthrie sang his Alice's Restaurant song, which went on and on. It was a really cool song. They even made a movie of it one time. You ought to check it out. It might be on Netflix. You might be able to get it netty, you know? So, anyway, one of the verses, Arlo began to talk about how Uncle Sam visited Alice's restaurant, and the agents came in there and said, "Now, son, we're interested in that. We're interested in getting the rainbow roach." You know, so see, I never got into drugs, hallucinogens, or anything. It's just like I had a feeling that doing that stuff would hurt my ability to paint. You know. That's after my friends started taking drugs. They started to do all this little cutesy little neat little airy fairy stuff, and they started to dress up in these like almost like Halloween costumes. I said, "Oh man, I start doing any of that, I'll never be able to do any more expressionist paintings," you know. So the body produces its own hallucinogens. That's right. Everybody makes their own drugs naturally in their body, except there may be exceptions. You know, I'm almost convinced that, well, anyway, we'll get to that sometime. As a matter of fact, yeah, it's coming up in the education section. All right. So maybe Uncle Sam did visit Alice's restaurant after all. And maybe they did actually have a talk with Arlo Guthrie, Woody Guthrie's son. Maybe they did buy that rainbow roach after all. Because though I cannot confirm it with some hard evidence, nothing good enough for a class action lawsuit. Like those mentally handicapped folks did when they found out they were used as guinea pigs for government experiments. And I can tell you all about the bizarre behavior of the men. Yeah, it was like the men. Because back in those days, they didn't have women in the army except Women's Army Corps. I thought that was pretty cool, but a lot of people made fun of that. And that wasn't because we were the baby boomers, drafted hippies, or anything else, you know, like that. Nothing could have explained it. Living in a barracks with my fellow GIs was a kind of hell, you know. First, there was a cacophony of amplified, you know, 60s-style rock music coming from each of the bays. Now these guys, they had their bays, and we didn't have sealed rooms, but we did have partitioned cubicles. Until the time when I was promoted to Spec 5, you know, and moved into the private room at the end of the hall in these 1940s types barracks that they had, made of all wood, you know. Hey, the barracks, it's like, it was shelter, you know. There were private rooms at the end of the hallways. We were on the second floor. There were two-story barracks with a couple of other Spec 5s. Air and Oros. By some coincidence, we were all artists. I, with my interrupted schooling at the School of Visual Arts of New York City, Oros from the Art Institute of Chicago, and Air, nobody asked him. I just realized. I think he was Cooper Union. I think he was a Cooper Union guy. That was a good school. My uncle went there. And Uncle Henry actually made a living as an artist. Not quite. He got into fabric design. You know. Anyway. But Air, I think, was Cooper Union. New York City, you know. One day, Air showed up with a floor fan. You know, one of these square, has a square housing, you know, that he had bought at the PX. He put it at the end of his bunk and tucked his olive drab army blanket onto it on the handle, you know, with the handle. There's a plastic handle that pulled up like this, you know, and you, that's how you carried your fan. You could use a handle. You didn't have to. Okay, so he tucked the blanket under there, you know. Okay, so it was this Air, you know, Dave's showing us some weird technique here, what's going on. That was the first time anybody, anyone, in the whole barracks got a good night's sleep. He explained his invention to us the next day, and we got our fans. Yeah, all right. Yeah, we had a little fan club going there. Our bunks looked like three giant olive drab grubs or slugs from a Class Z space movie. You know, we used the fans as a white sound, quote unquote, a white sound. Have you ever heard of that? Sure, it's catching on now. You know, a nearby sound, steady sound, that makes a constant uninterrupted noise that drowns out the other noises around it. You know, it drowns the further noises out. It only took a little while, you know, to get used to the sound of the fan near your head. And then you got a good night's sleep. You know, one guy didn't do so well. You know, one guy downstairs did not fare so well. You know, it's like we were not really able to share with anybody else our little creative effort there. It's one thing about artists. They're willing to do unusual things a lot of times. Anyway, you know, the decibel rating drove him mad. You know, they began to do this work in New York City, and they found out that, you know, if the decibel rating of sound is over 120 for a prolonged period, it will actually cause any human being to go insane. It will cause permanent, or at least it will damage the brain so bad that the person will become mentally ill. Yeah. It's a cause of mental illness. Flat out. It was a very good study, evidence, a lot of research, controls, the whole nine yards, and nothing happened after that. It's like nobody ever, you know, carry that ball further. I remember, you know, to this day in New York, you have to pay this huge fine if you're caught honking your horn for no reason at all, if you don't have an emergency or something. You pay a huge fine. I never thought they'd be able to do it. When I first got there in the 60s, there were, you know, like every day you went out on the street and you actually heard bah, bah, beep, 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 beep. Where they have two of them, three of them going off at once. It's like you go out there now, it's quiet. The only time you get it, you get a boop when there's the red light turns green and somebody sits there for too long, you know. bang, bang, like that. Okay, so, you know, he went, the guy downstairs went insane because of the decibel rating over a prolonged period. Of course, it didn't help that he had already gone through a tour, and at least one tour in NAMM, you know. So, anyway, the decibel rating drove him mad, and he barricaded himself behind an overturned double bunk until the guys in white jackets came and took him away, never to be seen again. Then there was the kid that got drunk every night and would, as he put it, fall up the stairs, screaming and laughing. Then he'd do it again several times. What are you doing, so-and-so? I'm falling up the stairs, you know. Okay. Some guys had huge, full-length posters in their cubicles. You say, well, okay, that's bad. You know, what's the big deal? Well, I mean, they had full-length posters of Ho Chi Minh, Joseph Stalin, Marx, Lenin, and so on and so forth. In 1968, when the hippies, big bunch of hippie folks in the United States, had their, you know, march on the Pentagon. I don't know whether you heard about that, but there was this huge organized march on the Pentagon. Thousands of hippies came from everywhere. It's kind of like a Woodstock without the bands, you know. They were going to try to surround the Pentagon and hold hands and make a human ring around the Pentagon to levitate the building out of its foundations and then drop it into the Potomac River. That was the plan, see. The Army sent in an airborne division, or at least a large part of one. Yep, they took it seriously. Punctuate that with a apostrophe. So at night during the episode, they, you know, the airborne troops would assemble on a street behind our row of barracks, and I was walking back from pulling guard duty at temporary building number 7, T7, the temporary building from the World War II era that housed the Army Material Command where I worked, with my gas mask and overnight kit. You know, I put together like toothbrush and some other stuff, some clothes, you know. And there were, you know, like, they had taken us and assigned us guard duties in the buildings where, you know, throughout Virginia where we were, you know, we worked during the day. You know, so I'm coming back to the barracks, and there were the boys on the steps with a platoon of airborne paratroopers facing them. It must have been prima facie. The guys had tacked a poster of Ho Chi Minh. Ho was on the exterior wall of the barracks there, and they put the loudspeaker, you know, of one of their stereos by now, you know, pointed out the window, you know, and they were playing a stereo, 33 and a third record, blaring out the march music, 76 trombones from The Music Man. I don't know if you remember that. The Music Man, he's going through and he comes to this, he's traveling on one of these cross-country trains in the late 19th century, and He's a hustler, and somebody discovers him, so he has to get off the train in Gary, Indiana, and to start from scratch. He ends up with this huge band. You know, he becomes the band master and marries the librarian. Marrying the librarian is a cute little musical. I saw the movie version of it. You know, about 20 of our guys were sitting on the steps, and one of the paratroopers in full gear jumped on the hood of a, you know, an army truck, parked waiting to take them out on the narrow street there, snapped to attention, and gave the Nazi salute to old Hose Poster. I mean, you know these guys had to have been stoned. I mean, what else could it be? They had to have been stoned. At the very least, they had to have been having flashbacks or something. What I'm saying is, you know, that people who are straight, who are not on drugs, wouldn't do something like that. No way. Now, there I was, stuck in the middle of all this. All I was trying to do was finish my tour of duty and get back to my art career. Little did I know, huh? I was never personally interested in drugs. I was convinced they would interfere with my creativity. I know they did with those who experimented with them in the hippie world around me. You know, the hippie world was infringing on our bohemian-type lifestyle. We had to live bohemian like that because of our economic situation. And here they were these pointless guys coming in, trying to be so cool. In fact, they would pretend that they were the ultimate, and then everybody else was substandard around them, you know. So it was a horrific attitude. It was like, it was synthetic imitation. These were not the real thing. These were wannabe cool people. And all they did was get stoned, get drunk. They started to swear. They had mouth. Love, peace, you know, all this like endless cliches. No creativity, no art, no poetry, no music. This is not like La Boheme. This is like La Cool Bum M. Anyway, so you know, I'm sorry. I had a very low opinion of all that. I managed to make it through that stuff, get along with the people around me. It's like you're the uncoolest guy on Facebook. Nobody ever talks to you. No, you never get a message. And so we're going to leave it at that for now. I'll be back with the rest of the story to be continued. Okay, now this is the next segment, part two. I had to take a little break there. Okay, you know, all I was trying to do was, you know, finish my tour of duty, you know, my 3 years, and get back to my art career. I had gotten through that without getting killed or anything, which was a miracle, kind of. And, you know, I just wanted to move on, man. It's like, get back to arts, try to get myself back into art school, you know. So, now, I was never personally interested in drugs. I was convinced they would interfere with my creativity, and I'm sure I was right, you know. I know they did interfere with the creativity of those who experimented with them in the hippie world around me, you know. And it's like, you know, that thing spoiled everything. It's like, they came in, there were weekend hippies that would come in, just hang out at the nightclubs. You know, out there in the village. You know, and they would be so aloof and so elitist. It was insipid, absolutely insipid. You know, for a brief moment, I was able to make something with that type of lifestyle. Minimize your materialism in order to be creative, in order to go ahead and do some artwork. You know, then you had all these like people come in who had no interest in the creative arts or anything else. It was like you know, like the bums down on the corner who all they would do is just hang out there all day commiserating with each other and getting drunk, you know, getting enough money to get drunk. You know, I'll be honest with you. I have to be honest with you. It was an invasion of parasites that absolutely neutralized that aspect of possibility. I don't know if that went on historically, but you know, you had all this filler, all these people, and then here they came with the, you know, like the cheap trinkets, you know, costume jewelry and all this stuff. It was the end. That was the end of any kind of creativity. So everybody decided to move down to Desolation Row and have a party, you know. So that wasn't what D Row was for. It was for artists in residence studios. Nobody ever got it. Anyway, so I was convinced about that, you know. So anyway, those people became incapable of doing anything significant or following through on things they were interested in, you know, because they were always getting, as they called it, quote-unquote, tripped off on things like a few cigarette ashes in a sink floating in the water, you know, or something like they would stare at, like, cigarette ashes in the water in the sink in the bathroom, you know, for like an hour or something. You know, oh man, I was tripped off, you know. Yeah. All those people were doing was encroaching on the lifestyle we artists had, and we had to use. I mean, we wouldn't have lived like that if we had some kind of income, you know. But we had to use that kind of lifestyle because of the poverty we had to usually endure. Now, you might think that, you know, how shall I put it? The top brass, you know, the ranking officers. You might think that the top brass runs the army. Think again. It's run by the corporals and the privates. The officers are scared of them. You know, I don't know if it's changed, but back then, you know, that was the situation. There is a kind of detente going on between the brass and the bottom. And if that line is crossed, things can happen. Like the time the new sergeant major took over the company on the South Base. He got right in there and started to straighten up the men and impose a reasonable sort of discipline among the ranks. A couple of spec fours, now this is the equivalent of a corporal, only they're specialists. New kind of rank system the army had developed. You know, a couple of spec fours or corporals got together over there at the Pentagon and loaded a program in the big old computer over there. And 6 weeks later, the sergeant major was shipped off to Vietnam. Yeah, probably his 10th tour of duty over there. Just because you've got an army, don't think you're going to get by. Because all kinds of things can happen. I tell you, you know, the officers were scared of those guys. You know? It's never going to go smoothly. That's why history is fraught with so much failure. Remember that Spec 4 or corporal that ended up causing all that trouble in Europe? Well, I should say, I was going to allude to Napoleon, but I don't know, maybe he went through some kind of officer school and came out. I have no idea, but I got it second hand. I tried to Google it, and I got all this, like, filler. And, you know, so there was a situation where you had a corporal. I think it was Napoleon. I'm going to have to do some more research on that. But then there was a corporal who got his start during the First World War. You know, remember him? Adolf Hitler? Yeah, corporal in World War I. You know, so, boy, that describes the guys in my barracks to a T. You know, a bunch of little Hitlers that history was passing by. Just remember, all it takes is one, you know. I tell you, you guys were pretty fortunate. You missed out on at least 30 of them just in that one barracks alone. Finally, the day came. Yes, the day came. I never thought. It's like, it's just this incredible thing. It almost seemed like it took forever. But finally, the day came. I had been accepted in the California College of Arts and Crafts in Oakland, California. I was out of the army. I was at the airport. In the plane. My 3 years of army service over. Sitting in my window seat. I fought the disbelief. I fought the disbelief. Any moment, you know, it got that way. Maybe it was the decibels in the barracks. Maybe it was something they put in the food. I don't know. Any moment, I felt like, you know, when I did KP, to be honest, I didn't see them putting anything in the food. So, anyway, so at any moment, I felt. I felt like that. I felt that any moment a bunch of MPs would barge in on the plane, you know. I was fighting that kind of imagination there. They would, of a bunch of MPs barging on the plane, carting me back to the South Base for another few years on some clause of some article of the Uniform Code of Justice or something else, something. But of course, it didn't happen. Just my imagination. Had to be something in the food. Anyway, the jet took off and circled the Pentagon before heading west. I remember the sight of that building twisting in the distance and disappearing from view. Boy, that stuff had a pretty profound effect, you know. So I breathed, man, I breathed a sigh of relief. I don't know where the air came for that breath. I breathed a sigh of relief so big, I began to wonder where all that air was coming from. Hey, what's for lungs? Man, that plane got me to O'Hare Airport in Chicago. You know, I think it's called OHC. And then the next plane went on to Oakland, California. Because we were headed west. And the sunset lasted for hours. It was beautiful. You know, we were flying in, heading west with the sun. So instead of just being a sunset, it was like this four-hour sunset. It lasted for hours, lasted 4 hours. I mean, it was beautiful. I was glued to the window most of the way. It would have been all the way, except that that was the 1960s before they had invented super glue. That was sunset glue, you know. So this reminds me of the time this guy couldn't afford a television set at the Mart, so he went out, sat on the hill, and just waited, and after a while he had him a sunset instead. Well, the next morning, after a fitful night's sleep, you know, in I forgot where. I think what I did is I checked into an inexpensive hotel out there in Oakland, California. I walked up Broadway in Oakland from downtown to the school campus where I was going to go to school. Then I looked around and tried to snoop for digs, some place to stay. I picked a road, College Avenue, that'll do. I walked down College Avenue. I picked a road, College Avenue, and started walking. After a couple of miles, I noticed a Texaco gasoline station. It was a real gas, man. It's that hippie lingo. Real gas. Shades of Hopper. 1960s style. You know, Hopper used to do these old Victorian type wooden buildings. Significant American artist. Early 20th century, I think. Okay, then something told me to look across the street. There it was, apartment for rent. I wasn't in the mood to be looking all day. After all, I was much too busy to take, gonna take a sentimental journey, looking for an apartment all day. Nope, I was in that office. I walked into the office. Oddly enough, it was a local ice cream company who made their own product on the premises. Now, local, I'm talking about local. I think they were Breyers ice cream. I think it was Breyers. But, I mean, that, I don't know if they started in Oakland, California, but they were local enough. They made some really good ice cream. Anyway, I took the place, and that afternoon I was moving in. Whew. You know, this was all too easy, it looked like to me. Anyway, that one thing I was good at all my life, I had been moving from one place to another. I had my first birthday on the Pacific Ocean somewhere, on my way to Japan back in 1947. Yep, I'm really good at moving in. I'm inexperienced. Yep. It's the next day, I went to the storage at the airport and got my bicycle. That's right. I took my 10-speed. In those days, 10-speed was the big maximum. That was a big deal. I had this 10-speed Jetan, beautiful metallic blue derailleur bicycle. You know, derailleur is the type that shifts the gears by moving the chain back and forth over a turret of gears. So before that, you had the only gear shift you had was the English bike that had a little chain, and the you would flick these three speeds, and the chain would switch gears inside the hub of the rear wheel. So, okay, so my, you know, it was a jetin. You know, jetin is the French word gypsy, and they made a really nice, affordable bike in those days. It was a French-made, French jetin, 10-speed derailleur touring bike. I bought it from Mel Pinot in Arlington. Melo is probably still going out there. He's from Morocco. He's a Moroccan who lived in France most of his life and then moved out to Arlington, Virginia. Mel was one of the best bicycle dealers in town. I moonlighted at his shop on weekends when I was back in the Army days, when I was at the South Base, until I got out. You know, so Mel gave me a job, and that's my first job, kind of assistant bicycle mechanic, you know. The Jetin was a reasonably priced bike for its, and it was the latest type of touring bike for its day. Anyway, as I was setting up in the kitchen, not very interesting. Yeah, where there's a kitch, there's a yawn, so you get kitch yawn, kitchen. I glanced out the window. It was a second floor, and there just outside was a huge avocado tree. As I peered between the branches, I could see the trucks rolling into the yard of the ice cream factory. It was the end of their day, and as I looked, I saw the drivers open the backs of the freezer trucks, take the boxed ice cream for that day, and toss it into a dumpster at the entrance to the back alleyway. The next day, I went out there and asked one of the drivers about that, and discovered that they only stocked absolutely fresh ice cream at their vendors. You know, and then they allowed me to help myself to all the leftover stock that they didn't use that day. I mean, I had moved into the right place. I was in ice cream heaven, man. So late that afternoon, well, actually each afternoon, I met the trucks. It was one of my big appointments of the day. I met the trucks to get the latest stock of ice cream, man. My favorite was Rocky Road. It's like chocolate, pieces of real, you know, like bittersweet chocolate in there with marshmallows. You know, although, you know, most of the time I had to settle for Parsons Delight, you know, because it's like Rocky Road was like usually got sold out. So I had to settle for Parsons Delight. Somebody must have turned out delights. Anyway, if you're ever going to art school, you know, don't go riding down the street on a bicycle, no hands, holding an artist's easel like a lance, and singing, you know, like the Don Quixote song from the 60s musical, The Man of La Mancha, you know. Because that's what I did, you know. Man, you think Cervantes was kidding? You think Cervantes, the author of the Don Quixote, actually there were two volumes, but now they crammed it into this one thick book. You think Cervantes was kidding when he wrote that? Let me tell you, those windmills are really out there, you know. Kid, I don't care how much you work out. You'll never be ready for what's out there. And it seems like they don't like artists. That reminds me of the time I went to art school in New York just after I got started and tried to jump the raised island walkway in the middle of Fifth Avenue and Broadway at 23rd Street while playing my harmonica. Yeah. I can tell you, I almost made it. You know, that's pretty good. I got the booby prize. I almost made it, you know. Well, yeah, that's the only time I made a hit on Broadway playing the harmonica. I didn't harm Monica, but I sure harmed myself. You know, I made a hit on Broadway, the wrong kind, crawling across Broadway before the oncoming traffic got there. The oncoming traffic was held back only by the time traffic lights. You know, they go, they'd have to move steadily at, I learned this when I was driving the cab. You can drive straight down Broadway, no stopping, because the lights are timed going down these big avenues. So you can drive, if you drive 25 miles an hour, you'll be fine. Now you have a situation where everybody else tries to go like 50 miles an hour, and of course, they're going to be start-stop, you know, until you finally get the hang of it, right? You know. So I made my hit on Broadway all right. I sprained both my ankles, you know. That was back before my army days, you know. Well, then, when they healed, I sprained my left ankle again. I missed 3 days of classes at the art school on that one. Crawling from bed to bathroom. You know, and that windmill was still after my butt in Australia. Then in Australia, see, the windmill got the other ankle. Actually, it was not a windmill. It was like a pothole, you know, in the street in Concord. Now, they don't call it Concord. They call it Concord, a suburb of Sydney. You know, I was in Concord going across the street. Actually, I was jogging across the street. And I missed that pothole with my eyes, but I sure caught it with one of my ankles. And that was really bad. That was the twist from down under, mate. It must have been the undertow. So, Cervantes was not kidding about the windmills. It's like all figurative, you know. So, I mean, it's symbolic. Anyway, it would really pay to read his book. He only intended to write the first half, but after quite a few counterfeits, you know, I mean, it was the beginning of spam, you know, everybody was coming out with a Cervantes-style book about Don Quixote. So after quite a few counterfeits that came out as a result of this book's popularity, Cervantes decided to write a sequel, which is why the book Don Quixote is so large. It's really two books in one, whereas in Washington, they passed the buck. In this case, they passed the book, you know. So the last time I was in Carlsbad, the Carlsbad Library, I told the librarian, you got to watch your shirt. This is a booky joint. You know, anyway, I'm going to read the book myself someday, you know. As a dyslexic, it takes me months to read a book, so I have to be kind of selective. So I keep putting it off. You know, maybe if I take up the clarinet, I'll be able to do it. Why the clarinet? Well, it's a reed instrument. Anyway, you must remember that Cervantes was an ex-soldier as well. Yep, he was an ex-soldier, a vet. When he wrote the sequence about Alonso Cahani, Don Quixote, a fictitious character, springing from the subconscious of this brilliant man. That what was intended was a quite cryptic representation of the real causes of the world's problems and the futility of one individual setting out to right all wrongs, which reminds me, someone asked me if I write my own jokes, to which I replied, I have to, they keep capsizing. You know, I have attempted to address that topic more directly in my less cryptic paper, which is, you know, on my, 4,000-page website, if you ever want to check it out. It's called The Predators of Man. The Predators of Man. I actually have read that on YouTube. It's now a YouTube video, so you can go watch it. Watch it now. Watch it. Watch it. So, there I was, anyway, to go back to Oakland after, you know, flash back and forth. So back to Oakland, there I was riding down the road on my bicycle, ostentatious as usual, oblivious to the adventures that lay before me and my two trips around the world in a late 20th century takeoff of the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, you know. That's right. You see the beard, see, like, man, it's a modern version of the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner. You know, I don't remember killing any albatross, but anyhow. Okay. So, so if you're starting art school, kid, you know, my advice is to go incognito, you know. Be as inobtrusive or unobtrusive as you possibly can, you know. But as I later find out, you know, as I later found out, even that can backfire on you, you know. If you try to blend in, you might just tend to stand out all the more. Well, soon I met another vet, an ex-Marine. He's also going to California College of Arts and Crafts, which we all called CCAC, you know. And, you know, he was looking for a place. So I took him as a roommate, you know. Then Todd needed a place to stay. So we took him in, too. And then I found about 10 other guys that were going to school but had no place to stay. So, we took them in, too, you know. Now, the place was getting a little bit crowded, and I began to do what I usually did whenever I moved to a new place as a kid. When I told you how I was inexperienced, you know. I was experienced at moving in because I kept moving, you know. So, whenever I moved to a new place as a kid, I found a way of getting onto the roof. And also climbed every tree in the yard, or wherever I could, you know. In this case, you know, I left the avocado tree alone, you know. But I did get up to the roof of the apartment building. I had to get up there, man. It's like, one of my favorite songs, and I'm glad it caught on, it was a popular song in the 60s, was On the Roof. Up on the roof. On the roof, it's called, you know. And yeah, that's it, man. Just get up there. You know, things seem to work out. Anyway, so I did find a way to get up to that apartment building roof. I had even slept up there a couple of times because something told me that I was going to have a difficult life. So, I didn't want to get too soft, you know. So, now, all the guys, except Todd and the ex-Marine, had to follow me to the roof where we all slept on the tiny white pebbles in the tar. I showed them the route. By no means must they ever tread on the roof of the ice cream factory, because I didn't want to damage it. And I was also afraid there would be footprints. You know, it was silver. It was a silver roof. Well, that makes sense, you know. But that's right. The entire roof was painted silver. It was quite a sight. Absolutely beautiful. Yeah, I guess it must have been, you know, like paint with aluminum flex in it or something. You know, so if it wasn't real silver, that would have cost a fortune. But maybe. Who knows? Anyway, the way to the other roof, you know, the apartment roof, was out the bathroom window and then traversing a tarred ledge. It was easier, though, to just clamber down to the next step below, you know, which was the ice cream factory roof, and then just walk around to the apartment roof, you know. But that was my rule, you know. You want to live there? The silver roof was out of bounds. But try, you know, try telling that to all the homeless guys going through my bathroom window, you know. Yeah, they were out of control, but, you know, things were getting more and more difficult. Before I went into the military back in New York City, I was used to the privacy of my own rented apartment, where I got a lot of artwork done, you know. Here, I wasn't getting a thing done, you know. Finally, one day, I laid down the law. This was my place, and everybody had to straighten their mess up before they left. You know, it's like the trouble. It's like, if you're going to lay down the law, you have to have some enforcement. You have to have some teeth, you know, in the law. And, of course, I didn't even have any teeth in the law, so nobody did anything. Nobody did. They laughed. They just laughed at me and went out to the park, you know. So, you know, I'm sitting there. What the heck am I going to do? Okay, I opened the window and just chucked everyone's stuff out. Now, it was mostly clothes. When I looked outside, I saw everything strewn on the lawn below. I thought better of it and was going to go down and bring it all back in. But the job was too much for me. I took off for my various errands. I now forgot what they were. I don't remember, but I had some important things to do. Really important, so I had to do them. I don't know what they were, but anyway, when I came back to find my gray snap-brim hat to greet me outside the door with a big, dusty boot print in the middle of it, squashing it flat, and a knife stuck in the drawing I had put on the door a month earlier. Yeah. Hey, I was faster on my feet than I thought. I didn't have to slug anyone, but after a couple of blows on my head from a beer mug, Todd managed to get the ex-Marine to cool down. Then we became best of friends. Don't ask me how that works, you know. But soon we were all laughing about it, and I was drinking one of the ex-Marine's beers. I hate beer, but I was thirsty, and I drank it, you know. Anyway, you know. Well, they say you have to acquire a taste for that stuff. I don't know. Yeah. I sang in the choir when I was a kid, and, you know, I never got to like the taste of beer. You know, it's like I was not into that kind of lifestyle. Not long thereafter, I was called into the ice cream factory office, as they were the ones that owned the apartment building. They were investigating leaks in the roof and found the footprints emanating from the bathroom window. I resolved the problem quickly for them. I moved out, leaving the place to Todd, the ex-Marine, and whomever else. I mean, whomever. And that's the story of the silver roof.